Well, let me tell you something. Men, I want to help you today. I read it. It's a British psychologist named David Lewis. He did a study for men from the ages of 22 to 79, and he found out this. He found out that Christmas shopping is hazardous to men's health. Come on, man. Thank God. I'm here. I'm your pastor. I'm your friend. I'm here to help you. In fact, their heart rate and their blood pressure was monitored, and he said it was equivalent to combat fighter pilots in wartime. That's not good for your heart. So now you can tell him. Pastor said, hey, he loves me, man. He's taking care of me. Not one in four women had the same heart rate and blood pressure. A friend of mine, he wrote about this. A good friend of mine, Dr. Mark Rutland, wrote about a moment when he got invited. He said, my wife finally got me to one of these, he calls it this way, modern American halls of torture called a shopping mall. And he said, finally there beckoned me by her multiple charms. And there I was. I stood benignly among the racks of clothes, just like other men who we dare not look one another in the eye, standing in obvious discomfort. But they would go into the inner sanctum and try on clothes. And there we, who once held golf clubs and rifles and shotguns, stood there holding the plastic repository bags, trying desperately not to recognize that we had been in the company of the domesticated. God help us, men. Help us. But you know, it's not only ladies. Sometimes some ladies can have a hard time. There was I heard the story of a woman who had a really hard, she just had it. She'd had it for the long lines, had it for trying to find the right gift and the pushing and the shoving. Has there been anybody here experienced anything like that? Good, you're all shopping online. That's the smart. But no, if you go out there, you know, it's like I have to do a lot of self-talk and tell myself, you know, I'm going to be parking a mile and a half away and all of those kind of things, and I need it anyway. But, I mean, I have to really work on myself, and since Jesus didn't come, I guess I got to go this week. But she had all she could have, and finally, with her bags and arms full, she backed into an elevator and everybody made room for her, and the door closes and she says, I don't know who's responsible for this, but they ought to be strung up and shot. And everybody laughs, a cordial laugh of, yeah, recognizing, identifying. But in the back of the elevator was a little girl, and from a little sweet voice, she said, don't worry, they've already crucified him. And that just like a child to speak the truth. We got to remember what this is about. In the middle of all of that, something more powerful than just this moment with that. And before he was crucified, he had to be born. And even in that moment, he was almost, and there was an intent, of course, to steal him and steal his birth. A real Christmas this day leads its message. We get our theme from the old children's Dr. Seuss classic, How the Grinch, or the Grinch Who Stole Christmas. You know the story. All the people of Whoville love Christmas, and the Grinch can't stand it. There are those who just can't stand for people to be happy and blessed. You can see it just grates on their ever-living nerve for somebody to be happy and to be joyful. Well, they got that same spirit, and the Grinch hated everything about it, and he hated it so much, he devised a plan. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to dress up like Santa Claus, go down, I'm going to steal their Christmas trees. I'm going to steal their presents. That's what it's about. And I'm going to steal their Christmas dinner. Now, he's gone too far, if you ask me, when you touch my food, okay? You got to understand something. I'm the last of 9 kids. And if you came to our, my wife said, why do you all hug your food when you eat? Well, you ain't grown up in a family of 9 kids. My gosh, I had 2 sisters they'd be going around that table, Mike. They'd go be, yeah, you've done that before. They go around that table, and you know what they're waiting on? They want to go out with their boyfriends, and they can't do the dishes until I'm done, and they're wanting to get my dish out from under me. I remember all that, and so he's going to steal all this, but we know it failed because something was much more important in Whoville than he didn't realize, but he finds out, watch this.
All right, guys, so we hope you're enjoying the service so far. Basically, in this moment, we're showing a clip from The Grinch, and weren't able to show it online because of copyright reasons. But in this scene, The Grinch kind of has a come-to-Jesus moment, for lack of better way of saying that, where he realizes that the way the Whos in Whoville are responding is kind of saying, hey, you know what? For us, Christmas isn't about presents under a tree, but it means a little bit more than that. And so I'm just going to take a moment here and just kind of read through the script of what's happening in this scene. And it just says this. Then the Grinch heard a sound rising over the snow. It started in low, then it started to grow. But the sound wasn't sad. Why, this sounded merry. But it was merry. Very. Every who down in Whoville, the tall and the small, was singing without any presents at all. He hadn't stopped Christmas from coming. Somehow or other, it came just the same. And the Grinch, with his Grinch feet, ice cold in the snow, stood puzzling and puzzling. How could it be so? It came without ribbons, it came without tags, it came without packages, boxes, or bags. And he puzzled and puzzled till his puzzler was sore. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more.
Maybe Christmas means a little bit more. Dr. Seuss and his wonderful message. Well, I want to tell you a story of another Grinch today, but a real one. A real one found in the scriptures of Matthew chapter 2. A Grinch that never even heard the word Christmas, and yet he tried to steal Christmas, and he's infamously known as Herod the Great. We've called him Herod the Grinch this year. He's become, because of who he was and the murderous spirit of his life, he's become the epitome of power and evil. Let's look at Matthew chapter 2, and I read all 16 verses. I'm going to tell you why I do this. A few years ago, probably about 10 or 15 years ago, a woman came to me and said, Pastor, I want you to know that we visited here and you read the scriptures during Christmas. She said, I realized my kids grew up 6, 7, 8 years old and they stopped reading the Bible for Christmas. Come on, folks. Let's read the scriptures. Amen. Let's read all of them. When you ask people, where's the Christmas story? You got to tell that just like this with no hesitation. And Matthew 2, it says, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born? Where is he who has been born, king of the Jews? For we have seen a star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and he's quoting the prophet Micah, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are you not the least among the rulers of Judah? For out of you shall come a ruler who shall shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child, and when you found him, bring back word to me, that I may come and worship him also. When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star, which they had seen in the east, went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, take the young child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose and took the young child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, another prophet, Hosea, out of Egypt I called my son. Then Herod, when he saw he was deceived by the wise men, was exceedingly angry. He sent forth and put to death all the male children who were in Bethlehem and all of its districts from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the wise men. Let's pray. Father, Well, that murderous spirit is still alive in this world, and yet we still are gathering together, and we're declaring the birth of our Savior, and we're reminding ourselves, and we're grateful, oh God. We ask you to help us hear this message, hear why it's here. Help us, oh Lord, to decide what king we're going to follow. I ask that you would direct our steps and our stops throughout this entire message. I pray that every person would hear, arrest their heart and mind, and they hear what they need to hear in this message. We're gathered here as the body of Christ, the people of God, those worshiping online with us who are in tune with this. And I pray, Lord, you'd minister their heart in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. He was born politically into a well-connected family. If there's any one man ever suited in history for his role, it would be Herod. By the time he was 25 years of age, he was governor of Galilee. 40 BC, he becomes, by the Roman Senate, he is selected. He's obvious reasons for why they selected him, because he was able to bring some factions together. But he now has become an appointed king of the Jews. Oh, the Jews hated that title for him. He was neither religious or righteous. But that was what he was called, king of the Jews. Herod, totally obsessed. Obsessed with four major things. First was power. Power, power. Oh, Herod loved power, and he gathered all the power that he could. He was obsessed with it. If it had been a drink, he would have been drunk on power. And Herod was so powerful, he would destroy everybody in his path. And in fact, he's known as capable, crafty, and cruel. When you describe Herod, you'd use all three of those. Quite capable, because he would bring together all these factions and work out peace. In fact, today, he probably could be the only one to bring real peace to the Middle East because of how crafty and how that he would able to do. He would use all of his political capital and things to bring people together, and he could never get enough power. But I don't ever underestimate him. Very, very crafty, very cruel. Over the years, he'd kill his mother-in-law, his brother-in-law, his two sons. He would even kill his wife for political expediency. This was a cruel, crafty, capable man. Power was his middle name, but he was also preoccupied with things, with possessions. You know, he built not one, but seven palaces. He built seven theaters. One theater had capacity for 9,500. Three times the size of this sanctuary, he built and filled them. Now, if that wasn't enough, he built an outdoor stadium that would seat 300,000. Now, people don't always have, what a concept of 300,000, okay? UGA in Athens has a football stadium for 100,000, triple the size of that stadium. And that's what, but let me tell you something else. He built the Jews a new temple. That's how crafty and that's how maneuvering he was. But he wanted to make sure that everything he did was for his own status and prestige. He built fortresses, 10 extra fortresses, and he named them after all of those superiors that he would be serving under. He would make sure that they had a plenty. And in fact, his paranoia that he was so occupied with, he made sure that every one of those emergency fortresses were well suited with armor and all the military might that he could and all the supplies he needed. This man, because his father being a king had been poisoned, trusted nobody. And he had a network of spies to sniff out any kind of distrust. And he was the king when Jesus was born. Now he's in the final days of his life. In fact, in the final months of his life, and in his condition, his body's racked with pain, he's got disease, he's having convulsions, foul breath, he's got sores all over his body, but he's still king. Don't ever underestimate him. And so it is in this moment right then that he hears the news. There are some visitors in Jerusalem, and they're looking for one born king of the Jews. Now that alarmed him, because he might have been appointed, but when you've been born a king, you have a right, you have a legal right, you have a bestowed right, you have a God-given right to take your throne. And he hears that there's one born, and his last act, if there's anything, he ain't going to have anybody taking over his throne before he's done and before his death. And so this one, he's born, and he's born with a title that he could only been given and only given because of what they could receive from him. And now this moment happens. So what he does, he calls them in. He calls this meeting. And we read this when this verse in verse 2 of Matthew, where he talks about when the one who's born king of the Jews, they come with this report. We saw his star in the east, and we've come. How far had they followed that star? 800 miles by foot. How far did you come to church today? Some people got up and it was raining. It was a little too far. 800 miles by foot and camel. 800 miles from Dallas to Atlanta is 800 miles that they would come over many, many months. So we know he's not a baby in a manger no more. He's more like a toddler, past two years of age, maybe close to three. But he's now a toddler, and they're looking for him. And he gets news of it, and so in his craftiness, he invites them for a secret meeting. Finds out that they're coming to find him and ask what time, when he had been born, at what possible moment. And verse 3 has a word, and that word causes everything in him to come out of him who he really is. It says, and Herod was disturbed. And because Herod's disturbed, all of Jerusalem is disturbed. And they are both disturbed. The word disturbed means to violently shake. And now he's violently shaking as he calls together all the wise men, all the chief priests and all the rulers, all the religious people who were serving his agenda anyway. And he goes, go find out where he is. And they know by Micah 5, it's Bethlehem. They know about the time. And so he just absolutely comes out of him all the rage and all that murderous spirit that you can imagine. Verses 7 and 8 remind us, he says, go make a careful search for him. Y'all go locate him, because when they had showed up, the star had ended. That's why they go into the court thinking that Herod's going to help them find. When they go back out, the star reappears. The star, I'm telling you, God won't take you a little bit of the way. He'll take you all the way to Jesus if you'll give him a moment. He'll show you everything in the heavens and the earth. He'll lead you right to Jesus if you'll give him a half a chance. You go looking in the wrong direction, you won't find those encouragements and that strength. But that star would reappear for the last 5 miles. For the last 5 miles. Can you imagine the excitement in them? For the last 5 miles. He said, go find him, and I'll go worship also. Oh, yeah, yeah, hint, hint, like you are going to worship another king. We know that that's why it happens, but we also know that these mysterious men, these stargazers, they are warned and they are left. In verse 12, they got warned in a dream and now they move on to their own country. And suddenly, Herod realizes he's been deceived. And every bloodthirsting, killing fiber of his body rises to the forefront of him. And keep in mind that the only way you can really understand what's about to happen is to understand that he has been called the King of the Jews. And now in this moment, one born King of the Jews, and the clash of a sudden impact of two forces are going to happen. And the scripture records it for you and I. Herod, all of his might and power, all of his craftiness and capableness and all of his cruelness and all that he has, power, resources, everything behind him, and Jesus in the arms of his mother as a baby. There can't be such a greater picture in all of Scripture for you and I to show us this moment. Immense power. Two kings in the same moment are going to meet in this point in history, both very powerful, but yet each one choosing to use their power differently. One using it to manipulate and murder, to create his own agenda and please himself. And the other, the servant of God, Jesus did nothing but live to please the Father and did nothing but heal, touch, teach, and give mercy and gave you and I what he looks like. And we all can identify him from anywhere. We can pick him out anywhere. That's the two. But is that all this is here for today? Is this here just for us to historically read a moment? And listen to me, it's amazing how archaeological finds are still confirming every bit of the facts of Matthew chapter 2. I've been in one place in Israel where they turned over the stone of one of those theaters and found out it was dedicated to Caesar Augustus on behalf of Herod. And Herod, once again, is found right there. Herod the Great, greatest oxymoron in all of history. Because if anything, he wasn't great. He was the epitome of that. But why is it here? Why is this totally bankrupt as a human being. Why is this allowed to be in these scriptures and we see Jesus as compared to him? Maybe there's something more the Lord wants us to see. Maybe in order to fully understand this, we say, oh God, help us. Help us look deeper. Look deeper within our own self and say, Lord, there are those moments when we want our way. There are those moments when we would rather receive than give. There are those moments when power is used for our own self. Maybe it's there to remind us that the struggle of what king you and I are going to serve is always with us. There's one that always crawls upon the throne of your life, and that king is called self. And Herod is much like that. So the little Herod inside of us wants to resurrect, and we got to keep coming back every Christmas and bowing down to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and declaring, you are the one born king of the King of all kings. And every moment when the little Herod magic comes out of our life, we go back and say, Lord, help us. Let me ask you some questions to help you with this morning. Which king is ruling you right now? Which king is ruling your heart and life? Are you infected with the virus of self-promotion? Is there craftiness kind of helping you find your way? How about, do you think more about yourself than everybody around you, your family and others and those that are in the network of your life? Is your thoughts consumed? Folks, I'm telling you, if anything COVID did, it brought out narcissism. Used to be hidden, but it's now everywhere and very well seen. But do you crave the power and the adrenaline rush that comes from controlling your own resources and your own destiny and then controlling people around you by it? And are you more afraid of what others think about you or do to you than you are about what God thinks of you and what God wants in you? Is that okay? Pastor, it's the week before Christmas, and you're here, you're doing. No, I want you to have the best Christmas you've ever had. I want you to be ready for it and say, I have bowed before the King. I've been to the manger, and I've been to the place where he is, and I declare, I join wise men that followed a star 805 miles in Jesus' name. Okay, let's go a little further. On a scale of 1 to 10, let's do a little assessment here. Let me ask you to scale of 1 to 10, 10 being high. Let's go down through these four things. Power. How important is control for you right now? Come on, a little further. Come on. Possessions. How important are the things you own? Does God have them in your hand to be able to release them? How about prestige? How important is status and how others think about you? Come on now. Paranoia. Are you trying to be protected from what others think or would do to you? Well, sometimes we got to pause.
Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody.
Well, I believe old Bob Dylan was right. You're going to have to serve somebody. I believe it's still a timely message. You're going to have to serve somebody. In fact, I'll tell you what, I believe you are serving somebody right now. Why don't you declare your allegiance to the one whose name is written above all others? Why don't you declare the allegiance above the one whom the writer in Revelation says, behold, I saw a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called faithful and true. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire, and he had a vesture dipped in blood, and on his thigh was a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Won't you declare this Christmas, he's not a baby in a manger. He's the Lord God seated above heaven and earth, and he will do his will in spite of the kings of this earth. Hallelujah. I believe that. I believe it's a moment to realize the massive universe who is a great God who sets upon the circles of the earth, and yet he invites you and I to his table. Isaiah said it this way, come, let us reason together. God's invitation to you and I to his table. Now, you may not be invited to everybody's table, but you're invited to God's table. And there you'll find an opportunity for you and I. He says, come, though your sins be as scarlet, they'll be white like wool. Though they be red like crimson, they'll be white like snow. Why would he invite us to his table? Why would the Lord? Because I tell you what, God wants to make sure that when you commune at his table, you won't allow anyone or anything to steal the Savior from you. You know, that's right. Power loses its grip when you see the all-powerful one. Possessions don't mean anything when you know that God's given them to you anyway, and he can give them to you again if needed. You're not trying to find prestige because you've done been forgiven in his presence. And why should you be afraid? Why should you be afraid? Because why have obsessions of paranoia when the Lord God be for you, who could be against you? Jesus said to Peter, Peter, I've prayed for you that your faith fail not. Can I tell you that the most alarming thing for me as a pastor is the last 2 years. I've seen more Christians afraid and failing, they're throwing their faith off, than I've ever seen in my life. I grew up as a child. I heard it first as a 14-year-old. I remember hearing, for my first time, I remember hearing, and I asked those around me, what does that mean when it says, in the last days, men's hearts will fail them for fear? In the last days, it'd be a great falling away. Now, I heard that, and I didn't know that it was going to be the threat of a virus that removed Christians from the faith. I'm telling you, you're more secure today than you ever been. You were secure 2 years ago before it ever started. You're still secure because his throne's never been threatened. He's never had an onslaught. There's never been a betrayal that he doesn't answer. And God is faithful, and he's in charge, and he's in control. He is, behold, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He says, come to my table so that I can make sure that you allow no one to ever take your faith, your saving faith from you. No one to ever, ever steal your faith. No one, nothing. When I chuckle at Herod, go find him so I can come worship. 5 miles. He was 5 miles from he who was born. He had no intention. Had no intention. He was going to destroy him. And if he didn't destroy him, he would destroy every baby boy in Bethlehem. Don't forget it. When you're grieving and suffering this Christmas, there's a whole village in Bethlehem who lost a generation of every boy 2 years in age and under because of a murderous spirit, the same murderous spirit that controlled Hitler and Saddam Hussein and many others after him. It's the same spirit that's loosed on this planet right now and loosed and foul. And those who give into the spirit of Herod use the very same thing. And yet he wouldn't turn 5 miles. I'm telling you, make sure that you're not so close to Jesus and never bow before him that you would be that close. And the tragedy is you would never bow and say, he's the king of my life. So we ask, Lord, thank you for your table. I love this song. It's called a Christmas song. I think it's good at any time of the year. But Adrian does a wonderful job of at this table. Listen to this.
At this table, everyone is welcome. At this table, everyone is seen. At this table, everybody matters. No one falls between. At this table, you can say whatever. At this table, you can speak your mind. At this table, everything's forgiven. There's enough for everyone. So as you are, remember that the door is always open. Yes, come as you are. The perfect gift that you could bring is your heart. So come. Come as you are. At this table, there will be no judgment. At this table, mercy has a seat. At this table, we're all sons and daughters. There's no place I'd rather be. So come as you are. Remember that the door is always open. Yes, come. Come as you are. Oh, come as you are. Yes. At this table, everyone is welcome. At this table, everybody cares. At this table, everybody matters. So come, pull up a chair.
Stand with me this morning. Please stand with me this morning. Father, we just look to you. We're so grateful to be invited to the table. Everyone can be invited to the table. You said, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Help us in this moment. Heads bowed and eyes closed for just a moment. Last time before Christmas, you that are worshiping online, you're in this room. Only God knows where you are. Only He really ultimately knows whom you're serving. But you'd like to say, I bow before the King of Kings today. Pastor, pray for me. I want to be right with God. Here's my hand. I want to be at the table. Pray for me today that I'd give my life to Jesus. I give my heart to Jesus. Yes, pray for me today. Yes, pray for me. I want to ask everybody in the room to say this prayer with me because it's the sincerity of heart that matters the most, but it encourages everybody. I want you to pray with me. Let's pray together. Say, Father in heaven, in Jesus' name, I ask you right now, forgive me of my sins. Thank you, Lord, that I can be invited to your table. I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. I ask you to help me to live for you as my King in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen. Can we give the Lord a hand for those who accepted Jesus as their King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Well, we love you today. Listen, we've got these communion stations here. If you would like to, then you would please come up you might need to sit toward the front just for a moment, but when one of them is open, if you as a family, if you can't be here Wednesday night, then come as a family, come to the table and allow your family to be ministered to the communion as we remind ourselves, set the tone this week with what Christmas really means. And from our table to yours, every person who are gathered with us today on this entire property, we are giving a gift from our table to you. We want everyone to receive this gift today just as a gift and a sign from God's goodness and graces and from His bounty. We share with you, and may the Lord bless you today. May you have a wonderful Christmas. Father, I lift my hand of blessing upon your people today. May they walk, Lord, favored and blessed. May they walk with goodness of heart. May they walk, Lord, submitted to you and knowing whom the real King is. May you be the Lord of all of our lives this Christmas in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The Lord bless you and the Lord be with you in Jesus' name. We love you. Merry Christmas.